procedure demonstrates the internal components of the 9100TS control valve.
We begin by looking at the sensor set that we have here. One has a shorter cord for the top of the tank, the other has a longer cord for the bottom of the tank. O-rings seal to the tank, and red clips hold it in. We then have a quick connect fitting that connects the sensors over to the controller. If we need to replace this, the first thing we need to do is depressurize our system. Please reference our videos on this topic for your bypass. Once the system is depressurized, we can install a new sensor kit. Inside the kit is a set of sensors for one tank, two clips, two O-rings, a bushing that is used on the Pro Elite and is not necessary for this install, and a silicone lubricant packet. To install the sensor, we begin by putting on the O-ring dry. Once the O-ring is on, we can apply the silicone lubricant. We want to make sure that while we apply this, we do not touch the gold pins. Once the O-ring is on, we can place it inside the tank and press on a red clip to hold it in place. The 9100TS uses two tanks. The second tank is held on by a couple of clips. It has an inlet and an outlet, but no control systems. So we'll remove this from the system in order to focus on the valve. To gain access, remove the screws on either side and pull the cover up and rotate forward. The first cord is our main cable. This is our incoming power, motor, and limit switches. The next cable over is the gray cable, which is our meter connection. We then have the two black cords, which are for the sensor sets for tank 1 and tank 2. These have a locking clip on them, so we want to press in on the clip before we pull it forward. We then remove the second sensor set from the circuit board. The cover can now be moved to the side. Once the cover is off, we can pull the sensor cords forward. We can then go through the hole in order to gain access to the screw and clip that holds the second tank adapter to the valve. Both sides have the same screw and clip adapters, so we remove the screw fully. Once the screw and clip are removed, we can move to the back side and remove the identical screw and clip from this side. Once those are loose, we can pull back the collar and pull the second tank adapter loose, where it seals to the body on an O-ring. As we move to the components on the valve, we start by following the cable over that goes over to our turbine meter. We can pull this up from the cord. We can see there is one flat side and the other sides are rounded. If we suspect a problem with the meter, we can run a magnet across the flat side of the meter. This should register flow on the control. If it does not register flow, we can look at replacing the cable. If it does register flow, we can look at repair or replacement to the turbine meter. As we untuck the cable, we can pull it forward in order to remove it from the assembly. We can then move over to the drain and injector assembly. We begin by removing any adapter pieces that are threaded into the body for the drain. We can then bring in our service tool in order to remove the retainer that holds the flow washer down. We can then see the flow washer that is inside the body. The numbers that are on the flow washer indicate how much water should run to drain during the backwash cycle. We can try to clean this with warm water and a soft brush, but should not use any metal tools to poke through the flow washer. If you need to replace the flow washer because you cannot clear the clog, you would want to match the number that is on here. If you're unsure what it was, you can check the housing or check the tag that is on the back plate under the cover to make sure you match the correct flow control. We can then move to remove the two screws that hold the cover for the injector and screen assembly. As we loosen the top screw, we want to make sure we hold on to the spacer. This makes sure that the body for the injector does not get crushed against the body of the valve. Once the screw is free, we can remove the assembly by pulling to the side and to the rear to pull it free from the body. The first thing that we have is our brine line flow control, which can be removed from the body by using a 3/4-inch wrench. Behind the white clip is where the flow washer is that controls our flow to the brine tank during the brine fill cycle. If we pull this free, we can remove the flow washer. If we look at the numbers that are written on the flow washer, it will indicate what gallon per minute it should flow. Make sure that when you reinstall, the number side faces in. As we move back over to the body, we can see where the brine valve is. This just pulls up and away from the body. We can check the O-ring as well as the sealing area to make sure there is no dirt or debris. We can press down on the spring and check all of the sealing area. If there is any damage, we would want to replace it. Making note that the 9000 and 9100 series uses a unique brine valve. If we have problems with a brine valve, we would also want to look at the O-ring that is inside the body. This should be checked for condition whenever there is a brine leak. Replace it whenever you replace the brine valve. On the unit, you can see that it indicates which injector and which drain line flow control were originally put in the unit. This is your first reference point if you need to replace any components. The 9100TS unit is an upflow unit, which uses a regulated brine cap. The nut that is on the top should not be adjusted or loosened. This regulates how much brine solution is mixed with the water to give you the correct capacity. As we remove it, we can see there is an O-ring that seals the cap to the body. We can also see a slotted screw head, which is opposite where the nut is. Again, this should not be removed or any adjustment made to it. If you have removed it, we recommend replacement of the cap as an assembly. This gives us access to our screen and two-piece 1600 injector assembly. We can remove the screen by pulling forward or tilting it to the side. The bottom end should be welded and sealed in order to make sure that the water has to flow through the screen before going to the injector. If this is built up with debris, we can use warm water and a soft brush to clean it. We recommend replacing it if the debris cannot be cleaned. We can then remove the two-piece injector assembly. The top piece is removed using a large slotted screwdriver. The second piece is removed using a smaller slotted screwdriver. This particular unit uses a 000 or 00-aught injector in order to accommodate the flow that it needs for the pressure and tank size it is spec'd for. On the back side, there are also two O-rings that seal the injector assembly to the body. When removed, we would want to make sure we inspect them, replacing and lubricating as required. With the injector assembly removed, we will return to the back side of the unit to remove these four screws that give us access to the rear seals and spacers once we have the piston removed. As we look into the side of the unit, you can see that in the opening that is opposite the injector, there is a white piece. This makes sure that we mix our incoming water and our brine solution so that it gets into the tank at the right saturation. We will then move to the front of the unit. To remove the back plate, we take seven screws out that hold the two pistons into the body, including two that are in the drive assembly. We can remove the five screws that we have access to and loosen fully the two screws that are inside the drive. Once those are loose, we can start to pull the power head forward. As we pull forward, we use the leverage of the back plate in order to remove them from the assembly. You may get some of the seals and spacers to come out when you remove them. For this demonstration, we're going to show what the valve would look like if none of the seals and spacers came out with the pistons. The upper piston is smaller. It does all of the regeneration steps that we have for tank 1 and tank 2. The lower piston runs from the front to the back of the body as it switches between tank 1 and tank 2 with this piston. To remove the seals and spacers, we use a hook tool in order to pull the seals. The spacers can be removed with a tool that has three pins that, when you press down, extend to grab the inside. We repeat this procedure with the hook tool and the spacer puller tool for the upper and lower pistons. Once we have all of the seals and spacers removed from the front on both the upper and lower piston, we can move to the rear of the unit. By removing these four screws, we gain access to the rear seals and spacers for the lower piston. When all four screws are removed, we can remove the plate. Behind the plate, there is a white spacer. We want to make sure that when we press this in, the side that is flat goes in towards the seal. We reuse a hook tool for the seals and our puller tool for the spacers. The last spacer that is inside the body does not have any openings in it, so we want to make sure that we remove that either with the hook tool or with our fingers. Make note that there is still one last seal behind that spacer. Once all of the seals and spacers are removed, we can look to install a new seal and spacer set. This will include 16 seals, 12 standard spacers, one small spacer, which is used as the first spacer in the back of the unit, and an O-ring. The O-ring is used if your unit came with a plastic rear cap. Since our unit used a metal cap, we do not need this. Aside from the kit, we recommend using a stuffer tool and Pentair approved silicone compound. If you do not have the approved silicone compound, it is acceptable to use soapy warm water. To begin the procedure, we start with a seal and add some of the silicone compound. Once the seal is full of the compound, we press it in to the end of the tool that has the metal cap. Once it is seated in there, we can press it into the body. Since this is the back of the unit, the first spacer is our special small spacer. We press that in and make sure it seats in the body. The remainder of the seals and spacers are just an alternation of all of the standard parts. So we continue with seal and then standard spacer for the rear until we get to the end, then move to the front of the valve, repeating the same procedure. Once the end seal is in, we can then move to installing the white spacer at the end. Again, making note that the flat side should go in on the body. We reinstall the metal plate with the four screws. Once all the screws are secure, we can move to the front of the valve and repeat our procedure of alternating between seals and spacers, making sure both the inside and outside end with a seal. Once we have all the seals and spacers in, if we need to replace the pistons, we move over to the drive assembly, where we have the black screws that hold the lower and upper pistons on. For the upper piston, we remove the screw and washer and pull the lever forward of both the upper and middle gear set. We then turn the piston sideways in order to clear it from the body. For the lower piston, We also remove the black screw from the gear assembly. We pull it loose from the gear and out through the back of the drive assembly. From here on forward, the reassembly process is the reverse of the removal. Good luck, and thanks for watching.